Hey, good morning, everyone. Good to see you. Hey, come on, you can be a bit more excited to see me than that. You know, it's good to see you. All right, I'm going to pray. What a precious passage, and that God would work in our hearts. Let's pray. Amen. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that in your Son, the Lord Jesus, that we are gathered together, that we are gathered to you, that we are gathered to each other, and that this church, your church, is precious. Father, I pray that as we think about the implications of this passage, that you would be our teacher and that the Holy Spirit would implant these words upon our hearts, that we wouldn't just hear them, but do what they say. And I pray this in Jesus' great name. Amen. Let me start with one of those phrases that I'm sure you're absolutely familiar with, right? What you value, you will choose, right? What you value, you will choose. Okay, it's one of those things that's just so obvious that it sort of almost goes without saying. What you value, you will choose. It's sort of given rise to all sorts of jokes, of course. If you heard about the one about the grand final, right? Imagine Nat as the AFL grand final. Okay, Nat's a big AFL fan, all right, over here. If you haven't met Nat before, I've just embarrassed her in front of the whole congregation. But Nat loves the AFL, all right, don't you? Yeah, good. All right, I've got this right. Whew, right? And imagine you're at the grand final, okay? It's at the MCG, it's 110,000 people, right? This is before COVID, you can actually sit next to people, and it's just jam-packed. You've heard about the one where there's two people sitting and there was a chair spare in between. And these two guys are sort of at the grand final and during that time, looking across at each other with this spare chair. And at halftime, the guy sort of leans across the spare chair and says to the guy sitting next to him, I've just been wondering the whole match, how can there possibly be a spare seat at the grand final? Surely, what's going on? And he goes, well, the seat was for my wife, but she died. And the guy went, oh, okay, this sounds quite odd. And he goes, oh, okay. And he goes, well, and he said, surely there was someone that you knew or another family member who could have come and sat with you during the grand final, given you just lost your wife. And he said, don't you have any friends or family? He says, yeah, I've got heaps of friends and family, but they're at the funeral. And and it's true that, isn't it, that what your heart values, you will choose, right? And you see, it's one of those facts in life that are true. There was the great Anglican reformer, Thomas Cranmer, in the 15th century, in 16th century, and he wrote the prayer book, okay? And he said this, he said, what the heart loves, the will chooses, and the mind justifies. What the heart loves, the will chooses, and the mind justifies. He was conscious at the time, there was this big debate around that people said, look, if you just change people's minds, if you just get them to think straight, then all of a sudden they'll be able to submit to what is good, they'll always choose the right, and we'll have this magnificent society that everyone's got the power in their own mind to choose what is good. Now, Cranmer, being a godly man and knowing his Bible as he did, right, he realised that that wasn't true, that he realised that because of our human nature and our human brokenness, the reality of our hearts is that the heart leads the way, the will then chooses what the heart wants, and the mind has a really good knack of justifying our decisions after that. And friends, we sort of know this is true, right? We're all busy, but where there's a will, there's a way. Isn't this true? What you really want to do, you'll always find time to do it. I find this, I don't know if you've ever tried to raise kids. I'm trying. And isn't this the case with kids? You try and raise kids and you say to them, right, how many times have you heard or said this phrase, right, I'm too busy to do that. It's amazing, right? And it's not my kids, of course, but other people's kids. At dinner time, right, all of a sudden you say, look, it's time to set the table, come downstairs and help us get ready for dinner. And all of a sudden, the cry from upstairs is, no, too busy studying, Dad. Seriously, for the last hour, they've been on, your kids, not mine, right, have been on YouTube and have been messaging each other. And then all of a sudden, something needs to be done. Oh, look, their head is in that essay. They are buried. They are very diligent for those 5 minutes when they actually had to do something, right? What you want to do, yeah, your will find a way to do it. How about for you? What are the things that you're busy, but you always find time to do, right? And don't tell me it's watching The Bachelor. When it's on. For whom is that the unmissable program on television? Right, no one wants to admit it, but But it can't be that popular and you're not watching it. At least there was some honest people at 9 a.m. Right? Now, I think it's degrading to women, but anyway, we'll go on from that. Like, I find it embarrassing to watch, but you're allowed to enjoy it. That's okay. But what is it that although you're flat out, right, you cannot not do? You know, is it the gym? Is it the beach? Is it hanging out with friends or family? What is it? You know, where there's a will, there's a way. What you value, you'll choose. And so I'm sort of hoping by the end of this sermon that you'll actually, some of us might change what we value, and therefore we might change what we choose. But that's what I'm going to get to, because that's what God does by His Spirit. Through His Word, He sort of grabs our hearts and changes them so that we might value and then will and then choose the things that He wants us to choose. Now, some of us are going to find this challenging because this, and when we get there, I don't want the challenge to sort of be you to feel beaten up by it. No, that's not my aim, right? My aim, because when it comes, you might go, I actually had no idea that this was such a valuable thing. And now I know it's valuable, and so I'm going to choose something different. Right? Has that got you intrigued about what I'm going to say? Well, this is what I'm going to say. The bottom line is this. I'm going to say today, this morning, that this thing that we call church, right, not other thing, this thing, 1045, Hope Church, gathered around His Word, is precious beyond imagining. That's what I'm going to say. That this gathering, what we call church, God's people around His Word, 1045, Hope Church, is precious beyond imagining. Now, for me to say that, right, when I mean church, it just means gathering, it just means assembly. You know, the word for church in the Bible is ecclesia. It just means mob, right? So in Acts, there was actually a riot in a city, and they said the church was rioting. It wasn't God's people rioting, it was just a mob, right? So church is a religious word, but really it just means gathering, and so it just means God's people gathered around His Word, which means that a denomination is not a church, right? The Anglican Church is not a church, right? It's a collection of churches. But what church is, when the Bible says church, it means this. It means what's happening right now. When the Bible talks about church, it's not talking about denomination. It's generally not church talking about all the churches around the world. It's actually talking about the gathering of God's people. It's not a denomination, many churches in that. We've got to get this right, because when I say this, this thing we call church, people gathered, is precious beyond imagining, I mean this moment. This moment, like this time, that's what I mean. Now, how can I say that? Well, it's because of what the Bible says, right? So look at Ephesians chapter 3. We're working our way through this book. Look at verse 10 in the middle of the passage. It says, this is the conclusion. This is the gathering of God's people so that God's multifaceted wisdom may be made known through the church to the rulers and authorities in the heavens. So God's purpose in us gathering is this, so that His multifaceted wisdom may now be made known through the church to the rulers and authorities in the heavens. Now, I just want to sit here for a minute, okay? There's something huge going on here. What this is saying is that the God of the universe is intent on showing His multifaceted, His many-sided wisdom, His rich and glorious wisdom to the powers, that is the evil powers and the good powers in the heavenlies. His intent on all of them knowing His multifaceted wisdom. That's His intent. And how's He going to do that? How is God going to show the spiritual powers that He is absolutely infinitely wise? By showing them the church. By putting us on display. By holding us up and saying, see, I did that. Now, you know how you're always learning stuff in church, right? I take it that for some of us, that's a totally new thought. That when God wants to show the magnificence of His wisdom to all of the universe, He says, look at my gathered church. Look at Hope Church 1045 gathered on a Sunday morning. Look at what I've done. That's what that verse means. Now, to get the context of this, you've got to go back to the start of the chapter. Look at chapter 3, verse 1. He builds up to it. He says, for this reason, I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus, on behalf of you Gentiles. So Paul is their apostle. He's about to pray for them. And then it's almost like he's about to get on his knees and pray. And yet we don't get to verse 14 to hear his prayer. So he sort of goes on this massive diversion and he says, let me show you what's going on in the heavens. Like, let me show you what's actually going on behind the reality of all things. So he then says in verse 2, he says, you've heard, haven't you? Thanks, mate. Oh, Zanny, you're a legend. Thank you. You have heard, haven't you, about the administration of God's grace that he gave to me for you. What Paul means, you've heard, haven't you, about the stewardship of God's grace, or another way of saying that, is you've heard, haven't you, this special role that God in his grace has given to me for your benefit. And what's that? Well, look at verse 3. It says, the mystery was made known to me, that's Paul, by revelation as I've briefly written above. Okay, so Paul was given this special role to reveal a mystery that no one else had been revealed to before. Now, to understand Ephesians, you've got to understand this word mystery. Otherwise, the whole book becomes a mystery, so to speak. Now, what does it mean? Because it comes up 3 times in chapter 3. It comes up in chapter 1. What does this word mystery mean? Now, you know how you can use the word mystery in a few different ways, right? You can use it in the sense of it's mysterious, okay? Like, it's a mystery. It's unknowable. It's mysterious. It's like what your wife really wanted for Christmas, right? You know when someone opens a present, they go, oh, right? It's mysterious. Well, Lenore's not here to defend herself, but that's just a made-up story. But you know what I'm saying, right? Or you can also use the word mystery, you know, sort of like a whodunit, you know, like a murder mystery. It's not that it's mysterious. It's not like you can't know it. It's just that the secret hasn't yet been revealed. Friends, God is mysterious in that sense. God's ways are not mysterious in that you can't know them. God's ways are mysterious in that he has to reveal the secret of his ways to us and then we understand them. He has to let the secret out. Okay, so look at verse 5. It says it there. It says, this mystery was not made known to people in other generations. No one before Paul could have known this, as it is now revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. The mystery is now revealed. What's that mystery? Look at verse 6. He says, the Gentiles are co-heirs, members of the same body, and partners of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. Right? This is the secret, that Jews and Gentiles together are in Christ. Now, I know when I said this last week, we sort of hinted at this, people came up to me and said, well, hang on, isn't this been the Old Testament story all the way along? Didn't God promise to Abraham that the gospel would go to the nations? Didn't he say in Isaiah that Israel would be a light to the nations? How is this a mystery? Okay, can I say, friends, that the mystery that's revealed in the gospel is not that. It was always clear that God would take the message of his promises to the nations. That's not the mystery. The mystery is how it would happen. None of the Old Testament prophets knew this. And that is, for the Gentiles to be blessed, they wouldn't be blessed by becoming Jews. That is a totally new idea by the time you get to the New Testament. Now, the Jews, they were the Old Testament people of God. The Gentiles were just everyone else. And the gospel you see in the New Testament is this, that Jews and Gentiles won't be blessed by the Gentiles becoming Jews, but by both of them becoming something else. Most Christians don't get this, right? That both of us will enter into Christ on an equal footing. Because you see, prior to the New Testament, prior to the Spirit revealing these things to the Apostle Paul and others, the Jews were on this, imagine this, they were on a train track, okay? And they were on a train track towards salvation, trusting in the promises of God, but also in obeying the law, in getting circumcised, in obeying the food laws, in doing the rituals and the sacrifices. That was their track. And the Gentiles, they were on a totally different track altogether. They were on the train track of superstition and idolatry and foolishness and on the train track toward destruction. And in Old Testament thought, the thought was that if the Gentiles were to be part of God's blessing, then the way that they would do that is they'd have to get off their train and get onto the Jewish train, so to speak, okay, and trust in the promises of God of the Old Testament. In other words, you had to become a Jew. And that happened all throughout the Old Testament. Rahab the prostitute, as they enter into the promised land, she joins. She's a Gentile. She becomes a Jew in order to be saved. And the more enlightened Jews, they wanted this to happen, right? But they recognized that the Gentiles, they were like the Johnny-come-latelys. They were the last-minute invites. Right? They were the ones who, once restrictions opened up, got an invite. Hasn't it been awkward during COVID? You certainly worked out where you've sat on the friend list, don't you reckon? Like, you know, I really feel for the people who've had weddings during this time, because you sort of, they could only invite 100, so you don't get the invite. And then it opens up to 150 and get invited. So you go, look, in the friendship stakes, I'm between 100 and 150. And it's just, it's normally unsaid, you know, where you sit. And all of us always think we're in the top 10. But, I do, right? But it become painfully obvious that I'm not in the top 100 for some people, but I'm in the 100, 150, and that's a good zone to be in. But I think the Jews saw it this way. But what was unknown to the Old Testament prophets was made known to the Apostle Paul, and God revealed a whole new track to them, that Jews and Gentiles are to be saved and to leave both trains behind, to keep the metaphor going, to leave both paths of salvation behind and come to something new. And that new track was Jesus. And that's why they killed him. Because you might be tempted to say, wasn't the new track the church? Isn't the new Israel the church? No, the new Israel, biblically speaking, is Jesus and everyone who is grafted into him. And so at this point, Paul's about to pray. And he's about to break off and pray for them. And he says, no, I want to tell you about my part in God's magnificent purposes to bring the church together. So let's come back to chapter 1, remind ourselves, right? Look at chapter 1, verse 8, verse 9 and 10. This is what God's secret plan was. Verse 9, he says, he made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure that he planned in him for the administration of the days of fulfillment to bring everything together in the Messiah, both things in heaven and things on earth in him. Friends, God is not mysterious. He has made known his secret plan, and his plan for all of eternity is to bring everything under the Lord Jesus Christ. And friends, this church and every other church is the first taste of it. This is the thing you can see that is the beginning of God's great work of gathering the nations under himself. You can see it. You can taste it. People brought together under Christ. That's why this is a taste of heaven. Yeah? Now, this is a sociological miracle that this has happened, isn't it? I mean, it's a bit of a human miracle to get Jews and Gentiles to be brought together. That's an absolute miracle. The Jews did not associate with the Gentiles. They didn't hate them, but they didn't eat with them. They didn't dress like them. They didn't associate with them. They didn't marry them. I mean, for you to be brought together, miracle. It's like if one of my daughters brought a Bulldogs fan home. Like, there's just some things that just you cannot sort of overcome. That's why we've got the Dragons jersey in the front room. It's just a little, like, the cross. We don't even have a cross on the wall, but we've got a dragon. Maybe this shows like my adultery. But, you know, like, it's just there, and it's just a little subtle reminder. We don't say anything. Just walk. They just have to walk past it. It's just like, okay, if you want in here, you just need to submit to the dragon, right? Okay. But it's a sociological miracle, is it not, Tanya? Bulldogs fan. I'm not going to make a comment on that because this is right. And I know there's Doggies fans here and there's hope for you all. But friends, it's deeper than that. It's a spiritual miracle, isn't it? I mean, because of the division between Jew and Gentiles, it wasn't racial, it wasn't ethnic, it was religious. Like, one was pursuing God by trusting his promises and doing rituals and sacrifices and keeping the food laws. The other was worshipping many gods through superstition, ancestor worship and idolatry. And for those to be brought together and to let go of their cherished religious traditions, that is extraordinary. And I know some of you here have had to let go of cherished religious traditions that aren't Christian in order to be united with other brothers and sisters to trust in the Lord Jesus. And that is a huge thing to do. It's a spiritual miracle. Because the basis of all of our acceptance before Christ is the merits of Christ, not who we belong to. It's a spiritual miracle, but it's also a miracle that overcomes sin, is it not? I mean, last week, didn't we talk about this, that our world is divided. Sadly, it's divided. Like whenever you look at groups, don't we just manage to get divided all the time? We divide old and young, rich and poor, hip and not. Well, I'm in the not. Right and left, blue collar, white collar. Like in our world, everyone just finds a just new way to divide so that they don't we don't associate with others. We keep dividing ourselves into groups. And how hard is it, do you think, for groups to stay together? You think of that little group called married people, right? Right? How hard is it to stay together? You think about it. You find the one person in the world that you like the most. And then you get together with them, right? And then how hard are they to hang out with sometimes? Right? Give it a few years and that person just becomes so annoying, right? Sorry, she's not here to defend herself. Like, trust me, like, live with me. I'm much more annoying than Lenore. Like, this is a general statement, all right? I feel like I've dug a hole that I can't get out of here. But it's like, all right, I'll do a different one. It's like going away with groups, okay? A few days is great, but don't do it. Just really don't. Like, you might just think it's your friends, but they're really annoying. Don't you find this when you go away with groups of people, right? It just ends up frustrating and petty. And is it just my friends or is your friends like this too? Like, if you go away with friends, just make sure it's a big place, right, that you've got separate tents, like, whatever you need to do, because everyone's friends are annoying. They really are. And not only that, you add age into the mix. Like, if you go away with old men, okay, like, you've got no chance. They are grumpy when they're in a good mood. And so you put them with a group of people they're not normally living with. Like, it is, do not go away with anyone over the age of 42. I'll put myself in there, right? Because what's going on? The problem is that little word called sin. What keeps breaking us apart is our sin. It's the sin in others. They are so annoying. It's the sin in you. You are so annoying, right? And if sin means also that I'm less patient, I'm less gracious, I don't bear with one another in love as I should because I'm a sinner, and all of that means that we keep dividing into groups and groups and groups and groups and groups. And this is humanity's story. But here's something you may not know. It's also the righteous judgment of God. Have you noticed that? You know in the Bible how it talks about we've rebelled against God and that we therefore scatter from each other? The Bible actually teaches too that not only do we scatter from each other, but God confounds that and confirms it and he scatters us further. So the first famous example of that is the Tower of Babel, right? Remember the Tower of Babel? They build this massive tower up to God to make a name for themselves, to try and rule the world under God themselves. And what does God do? He confounds it. He says, not only am I going to scatter you, but I'm going to scatter your languages so you can't understand each other. In other words, God not only confirms their sin, he scatters them and makes it worse. Now, why does he do that? That's his judgment. So what do you think his beautiful salvation would look like? If scattering is his judgment, what does salvation look like? It's gathering, isn't it? You see this vividly leading up to Jesus' death in John 11. Look at John 11. The religious leaders are arguing about Jesus. Can you believe this? It says one of them, Caiaphas, who was high priest that year, said to them, "You know nothing at all. This guy doesn't trust Jesus." Remember this. "You're not considering that it is to your advantage that one man should die for the people rather than the whole nation perish." He did not say this on his own, but being high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus was going to die for the nation. Just an aside, isn't this really interesting? That's prophecy. And you don't actually have to be aware that you're prophesying in order to prophesy. Like, I reckon there's lots of people in our church who prophesy. Right, which just means that they sort of really apply the word of God into people's lives in a way that is impactful and God uses, even without them being aware of it. That's a talk for another day. Look at verse 51 again. "He did not say this on his own." How did Caiaphas say this? "But being high priest that year, he prophesied that Jesus was going to die for the nation, but not just for the nation." Verse 52. "And not only for the nation only, but also to unite the scattered children of God." Friends, why did Jesus die? To forgive my sins so that I could go to heaven? No. Well, not entirely. That's true. But not entirely. No, he dies to gather a people to himself. to gather us to himself. He gathers us by shedding his blood that we might be gathered into his church. Friends, this is Christianity. You come and you submit yourself to the Lord Jesus. His death covers your sin and it covers my sin. And so we're not only reconciled to God, we're reconciled to each other. And so the basis of my identity now is not that it's me and the Lord Jesus. It's that I'm united to him, and therefore by his Spirit, I'm united to you. Therefore, what you can say of him, you can say of us, right? He's justified, risen from the dead, forgiven. So are you. He's raised. So are you. He's gone through all of that already, and by the Spirit, we've all gone through it with him, so much so that the church now meeting here, we're gathered right now in the heavenlies. And Paul proclaimed this message, and he said to the Jews, let go of your works righteousness, your rituals and your sacrifices. Let go of it and come to him. And to the Gentiles, he said, let go of your superstition and your ancestor worship and your darkness and your idolatry and come to him. But here's the thing. If we come to Jesus, we come to his body that we've been united into. Do you see? The purpose of Jesus' death is to gather a people, a scattered people, to himself. And then, because he's so good, he gives us his Spirit, who then grows us in one of those things, the fruits of the Spirit. What are they? Love, joy, self-control. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, self-control. I always forget the one. And gentleness and faithfulness. Why do we need to be grown in all the fruits of the Spirit? It's so that we might bear with one another in love, and so we might deal with the sin that would so often divide us. Friends, Jesus died to make Hope 10:45 a.m. happen. That's why he died. He bled and died to make this meeting this morning possible, that the sin would have kept us apart from us and God would be dealt with, and that the Spirit would draw us to him and to each other. Now, that's why Jesus died. It wasn't about me and God. It was about us and God. Now, so often we think very little of church, right? And I'm a minister. We can do this, right? We think really little of the fact that a sinful people can be brought to God and therefore brought to each other. But that this is so is astonishing. Now, look at verse 8, what Paul says. He says, this grace was given to me. He's excited about it. That the least of all the saints, and he's a saint in the sense that he's a Jewish Christian, right? And he's a murderer, so that's why he considered himself least. He said to proclaim to the Gentiles the incalculable riches of the Messiah and to shed light for all about the administration and the mystery hidden for ages in God who created all things. Friends, he is staggered that he gets to be part of this great work of seeing the nations come under Christ. So come back to verse 10. Where we started, it says this happened so that God's multifaceted wisdom may now be made known through the church to the rulers and the authorities in the heavens. Friends, this gathering exists so that God might say to the spiritual powers, I did that. By the blood of my son, I did that. I cancelled sin and I gathered them together. Now, you won't get that by looking at us, and that's the problem, isn't it? Don't you reckon, right? Which is why we sort of need teaching on this. I mean, you wouldn't get this by looking at this group of people. I mean, look around, seriously. When you look at us, you know, we are, well, at least you are, not very impressive, don't you think? Oh, come on, have a sense of humour, people. This is what we are. Like, look at us. We're just a bunch of people with our hurts and our hang-ups and our baggage and all kinds of allegiances and sins. And we're impatient and grumpy and selfish and we're all of that. And just looking at us, you wouldn't think that God's church is very impressive and that the powers in heaven would be afraid of anything. But friends, when you look at this gathering with spiritual eyes, eyes that are actually shaped by the word of God, you will see this as something astonishing and precious. That the people like us come together says something. That a people like us stay together, that says something. Like, let's face it, like, I wouldn't choose you as my friends, right? Well, yeah, I would. I like you guys. Like, I'm a people person, but you might not choose me either, right? Okay? And there, you know, and you look around the room and you see there's a whole bunch of us and we have some things in common. There's some people we might be drawn to naturally, right? But why are we hanging out together? We're hanging out together because what is chief in my identity is that I'm in Christ and you're in Christ. And that is so important to me that whatever differences that we have, chief in my identity is that we're in Christ. And so if you're in Christ and I'm in Christ, then I'm going to gather with those people. And in fact, that is going to be my highest priority in life. That's what marks us. Like, why is it that you've come to hang with a bunch of people today that you don't even like? Right? Well, I hope you like each other, right? That's the Spirit working in you. But to be honest, do you know, as a Christian, you don't have to like everyone, but you have to love everyone. Let's be honest. There's people you just don't like. Like, you're just not drawn to other people. Be honest about it. But we're called to love each other. Why? Because our identity in Christ trumps everything else. Let me show you the honest challenges that come out of this, because I get to see this, right? Church doesn't look or feel very impressive. Therefore, you can actually go through your whole Christian life and miss out what is actually God's greatest treasure. God's greatest treasure is this gathering. This is what he treasures the most. Now, you know when you get desperate, well, maybe you don't. You get desperate for sermon illustrations. You go onto Google and you go, one of the things, I'm just admitting, right? You go on and you go, what's precious beyond measure? Or what did I put in? I said, what are things that people don't realize the value of and then regret it afterwards? Or something like that. Do you know what came up? Pyrex, right? Or Corningware. Who realizes this? Okay, now who knew? Okay, I went on this. People love vintage Pyrex. Okay, so much so, do you know a butter dish? Who knows what I'm talking about? Those, you know, those granny dishes, right? You know, do you know one of those Pyrex butter dishes went the other day on eBay for $225? Like, that's nuts. Do you know there are other listings too? Bowl sets that go for more than $300, and you can sell a chip and dip for $100. How good's that, right? So it turns out that, you know, granny's old dishes are actually worth something. And do you know, a friend of mine, you know, said that once they had a whole set of Pyrex, like would have been worth thousands. You know what they did? They just took, they didn't know what it was worth. They just took it down to the op shop and gave them the lot, right? And then someone swooped in knowing what they saw and got it for like $20, right? Sold it for thousands, okay? Now, friends, do you think they would have treated it any differently if they knew what its value was? Well, I take it they would, right? Friends, you know nations have battled over this gathering. The Son of God bled and died so that we could meet this morning. Now, I'm not saying this to have a go at anyone, like, you know, but I think lots of us have no idea how important the church is in God's eternal purposes. You know, and we sort of treat it sometimes like granny's old dishes, you know, chuck it out to the op shop. You don't realize what we've got. And, you know, I get it. You know, there's other stuff we've got to do. And, you know, I'm like the permanent taxi on a Saturday as well. Like, I know how busy our lives can get. But what the heart values, the will chooses, and the mind justifies. And if the heart doesn't love it, you won't choose it. And my task is to actually give you a heart for it, right? That you might see this and value it for what it really is. And it's not for what you can get out of it. It's actually for what you can put into it to the glory of God and display to the heavenly powers his honor and his glory. I want your will to choose it. But isn't it true, right? If that's true, then I want to say, friends, that this gathering matters more than anything else in all of your life. Right? Caring about the health of this community and throwing yourself in love into it and investing in it and serving your brothers and sisters within it matters more than anything else that you do. Now, of course, the pastor says that. But I want you to have the conviction that that's actually how you see church. Because here's the teaching spot. Why is it hard? It's hard because of sin, is it not? I mean, I get this. I mean, if God is going to display the church to the universe, to the spiritual forces, and say, this is the evidence of my greatness, what do you think the spiritual forces are actually doing right now? What do you think they're trying to do? Right, because Satan and his demons are real. They have influence. They can't control you, but they can tempt you. Yeah, there's this battle, and the battle is going on for you to be here. Sin, under the global influence of Satan, the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the ruler of this age, he is trying to shape the world in such a way so that you don't want to be here, that you find it hard. It's a spiritual battle that's going on. He wants to shape life in such a way that gathering amongst God's people is not, that isn't given the value that it should. And not only that, you add to that, you know, the sins that we carry along in the body and the issues that we can have with one another, and it gives us all sorts of reasons why we might drift. Now, I might be blissfully unaware, but I reckon, I hope we don't have this super attendance problem. This is not a participation problem. I don't think this is our thing, but I think it is amongst some of us. I've heard someone say this. No one's getting dobbed in. I don't know, you know, this crew, they just don't have the hobbies and the likes that I have, and I want to go and find a group of Christians that, you know, is sort of like me and has, you know, that all of our kids' ages line up and all that sort of stuff. Can you see that if you believe that ultimately, that you haven't quite understood the gospel? Because if our interests are the basis of our unity, then what that shows us is that our interests matter more than Christ. And it's Christ that gathers us from all sorts of backgrounds, and the church is beautiful like that. I mean, think about the Jew. They had to hang with the Gentile, right? The Jew could have said, you don't do our practices, you are not like us, you don't share our culture, you do not share our history. No, God has created one new humanity and taken down every barrier that would divide us. And friends, you have to see this gathering with spiritual eyes. Otherwise, we won't do it. And our nature rebels against this. Okay, so can I speak to the blokes for the moment? I'll finish with this, okay? I want to speak to the men in particular. Why? Well, because I'm a man and I get you guys, all right? So here we go. Here's my chance to offend all the men. So women, you can listen on and tell me if I've offended them, okay? Right, I think one of the things that men in particular, for tons of reasons, struggle with is that we don't tend to be as social, okay? We tend towards caveness, I call it. We like to hang in our cave, right? Not only that, it's sort of dangerous because we end up developing a theology that says, you know, it's just me and God and, you know, I don't have to go and so it's just the two of us. Like, no. Friends, a churchless Christianity is not Christianity at all. Like, if we claim to be spiritual and in touch with the Spirit and not churching, unless you physically can't do it, unless it's COVID or unless you're infirmed or there's all sorts of good physical reasons why you can't come, but by choice, you've at least quenched the Spirit or perhaps you don't have Him at all. Men, let's recognize our desire to retreat and just to stay in our cave. And I want to say, where there's a will, there's a way. What you value, you will love. What you love, your will will choose. What you choose will lead to action. Can I encourage you, men, to participate in the life of the church? To love it, to stick around, to plow into it. Now, this is, to be honest, I might be biased, but this is not a tough church to do that in. This is like easy street in order to get involved. And can I encourage you, men, if you lead a family, to lead your family in this, to be the one that urges your kids to get along, to the one that urges your, you know, the Bible out on the table, to urge the others around you, the other men, to lead their families, to love the church and to value it and to invest in it. Can I say one of the most beautiful things I see on a Friday night at the Hub, right? And sometimes there's one of the dads who's serving out here doing something, and then his son or daughter comes alongside and serves with them. I don't mind that something's getting done. That's not what I'm excited about. You may think as a minister I'm excited to see people doing stuff. I really don't care that much about that. What I care heaps about is that there is a father who is valuing, right, the place of the church and together. And not only that, he's teaching his kids. And I think what a blessing to be a child of that dad that gets to come alongside his father and to see the value of gathering as God's people, and that he doesn't put something else in the way of that. Friends, can I say that this gathering is precious beyond all things? And what I mean by that is 10:45 Hope Church on Sunday. The universe watches on and waits for this to happen. Can I pray that we'd all value it as God does? Why don't I pray? Let's pray. My dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that in the Lord Jesus, we've come under Him.
And therefore, we've been united to you and to each other. Father, we thank you that the heavenly powers see your absolute glorious wisdom when this happens. That you look magnificent in that the blood of your Son, the Lord Jesus, has gathered us to you and to each other. And I pray, Father, that we would so value the gathering of your people that we would cast off anything that would distract us from participating in what you are doing in the world as you gather people to yourself. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.